Vabbè, fate la
So, we've been working on this since 7:30 in the evening, and still we are late. But thanks for everyone for being here, and now Spaghetti Time 15.
Yes, sir! So, good evening, everyone, and very happy to see so many people, so many fresh faces. Welcome to the new Matricole, which is freshman in English, whatever. And a big applause for everyone for being here, and for our guests. Alright, so let's brew it up! Come on!
A big thank you to everyone that is helping Spec and Tech to survive, to cut the spec, to bring people, to advertise, to prepare the room, move the tables and stuff. It's very, very appreciated. A big applause to everyone who's cutting the spec, please, thank you.
Alright, enough with the applauses, I guess. And so, the guest for tonight, first one is Dario from Tron, or here. Yeah, Tron. And no, just wait it in a second, sorry. Tron is a company I personally work with in Belka for a long time, and so I have kind of an emotional feeling tonight. Not in that way. But I'm very happy to see them here, and well, it's something that we've been dreaming about for a lot. And they're coming from Piazzola Subrenta, which is not the moon, but it's quite a long way. So thank you very much, guys. And for the second guest instead is, he's been one of my favorite courses ever while I was at the university, Alessio Guerrieri, and he will speak in behalf of Spazio Dati, which is one of the best company here in Trentino, and they are very close to here, which is not Piazzola Subrenta, but still, thank you very much for being here and preparing a presentation for everyone.
Another great speaker. Introduction about our sponsors, so the people that are making Spec and Tech happen.
Right, so Impact Hub is the place we are right now, so it's a co-working space. Probably already people heard about this stuff like one of the times, but whatever. Impact Hub is the place you want to be in Trentino if you need a co-working space, probably it's the only one again. And it's the place where we are like right now, so big thanks to Impact Hub, which is our host for every event. And then we have Fiat Digital.
Fiat Digital is my organization, and they are actually sponsoring this event. And actually, in a couple of, I noticed that there are a lot of people from the second year of the university. So if you're interested in a master's school, they have a very interesting master's school. If you have a startup, they are actually helping you to scale it up. So just contact me after the event, and let's discuss about that in the upcoming days. Then we have Belka.
Right, Belka is my company, we do software, we do design of interfaces, we like Spec and Tech, we pay to make Spec and Tech happening, that's the story. Let's go on. And then we have Cloud, sorry Francesco, I'm eating the words. And then we have Faturi Cloud, which is our lead sponsor, they are helping us giving Faturi Cloud, of course, and so that's why we are registering people and blah blah blah. We are now an association, so this means that we have to deal with a third guy, which is the Stato Italiano. It's a nice guy, they gave a lot of things like roads, but the other way, they want a lot of paperwork done, and they are helping us doing that.
And then we have JetBrains. I don't know if you know, but if you donate tonight at the end of the event, we will raffle three full event, how do you call that, invitations, licenses for using their softwares and their own suite of whatever, the PyCharm and a number of softwares. I'm not a developer, guys, sorry about that. But yeah, if you donate this stuff, we will raffle three licenses for that. And then we have Diginate. If you notice our beautiful stickers, they're actually sponsoring them. So they're based in the UK, but they made stickers for a lot of different countries around the world, and they're very, very cool. So just look them up on Facebook. And as you see, this was the first edition of the sticker, and as in Game of Thrones, we have different seasons, and this was the second one. So take a look at them. They are the donation table over there at the entrance of the room. And then, yeah, of course, Segata. Segata is our provider of speck, and of speck, of cold cuts, of meat, of cheese, whatever you're into eating, they are providing us. They're based in Gardalo, they have a hub in Gardalo, but they're based in Sopramonte, and they're beautiful. Like, you will taste it. Yes, so we have our website. If you go on spacant.tech, you can see all the previous issues, you can see all the events that we organized, the slides from the people, whatever you want. And we also have a hidden treasure over there that will appear in a couple of days, but we're not spoiling it.
Are we?
Okay. Yeah, and you can also go on our Facebook page at spacant.tech or on our Telegram channel. We try not to spam, we're spamming sort of these days. But it was to have this room so full, so thanks for being here as well.
We stopped spamming, we promise. Yeah. There is too many people, sorry.
Yeah. Final point, do you have to donate? No, you don't have to donate, but you're invited to, because we have a lot of costs along the year to keep this running. We have to pay a lot of taxes and stuff for actually registering the association. And when you can donate, anytime. We have the table over there, so you just go there and you drop a coin. Or also if you want something bigger, yeah, it's fine, I guess. No?
Yeah, by the way, SpacantTech is a non-profit association, so there's no way me and Francesco can benefit from the money you're
putting. But Michele maybe, yes.
Yeah, maybe Michele, because he's the guy we trust for money, but he's a good guy.
And these are the beautiful t-shirts. I don't know if you noticed, but we are on some.
And we are a couple.
Yeah, sorry. Just go on at the table over there. Michele is waving it as if he was a cheerleader. And you can go there and get a beautiful t-shirt for your SpacantTech experience. What was that? Okay, nobody knows.
No.
Oh, yeah, I guess so.
Okay, so big news for tonight, but we didn't spoiler it because we wanted you to be concentrated for this real event. We are hosting the hackathon from the team per la trasformazione digitale here in Trento as well. Probably if you follow me on Twitter, you already know that because that's where news happens. But not really. That's really, really, really interesting. If you are a developer, there is the website and we will post it on our social medias and website as well. It's a very cool event and we are doing like a hell of work to make this happening. So I highly encourage you to participate. The team per la trasformazione digitale is one of the coolest, probably the only thing happening. It's probably one of the only and very lonesome stuff that is happening, which is cool from the Stato Italiano regarding IT, computer science, and everything. They're really trying to change stuff. So please support this stuff because I think it's something very, very interesting and cool.
The hackathon will be on the 7th and 8th of October. Will last 24 hours and you will develop on the actual API and services that are provided by the digital transformation team. And actually it will allow to do a number of things like payments to the municipalities around Italy and a number of cool stuff that is not possible at the moment, but via this hackathon happening in 25 cities around Italy, it probably will. So you will know more about this stuff happening in our social media and in our communication channels.
Yeah.
But
only one last thing. Sorry. It's developer oriented, so it's not like HFARM hackathons, which is let's throw a concept and do it. It's really developer oriented. So coders are welcome. Yeah. Just something I want to point it out because I think it's relevant.
Good point, and I would say that now we talked enough, you probably are bored with us. So we leave the stage to our first speaker for the night.
Yeah, Dario. Big applause to Dario, and welcome to SpacantTech, second year.
Thank you everyone, especially for the organization for having us here tonight. So, we have to be ready for the 175 slides. I'm going to be quick. So, first of all, a brief introduction about me and the company I represent. I'm Dario D'Agostini. I'm a co-founder of Drone and I'm CTO of the company. So I'm in charge of all the technical decisions for the company. And we are a 50 plus employees company. Based in Italy, Piazzale Subretta is our headquarter, but we have global operations. We have small offices, especially in the UK, and we are currently in a phase where we are expanding our market presence, our market share in the EMEA area. Few words about us as a size, as a company, as a type of target, not to brag about ourselves, but I'm here to share our experience, I'm here to share some things we do, and to put them in context. It's important to understand the level of availability, the level of performance, how critical it is for us to have things up and running all the time. And the main point is that we are already been working with important brands, and we're going to improve this list in the next weeks, months, and years. We have also been recognized by Forrester as one of the most interesting digital asset management companies. I'll come to this later. Our mission is to close the gap between the brand and the people in the digital environment, which sounds something common, but the way we do that is different because we start from assets, we start from content, and our concept is to apply artificial intelligence to content to understand what the content is about, manage the content distribution across all channels, social, brand channels, websites, mobile application, whatever, and to collect information about how users interact with content and understand what they are looking for and what they are interested about. So this is our goal as a product. It's a software as a service solution, and it is entirely based on public cloud services, mainly Amazon Web Services today. Just a few metrics to give a bit of context about the architecture, the infrastructure. We are not very big, but we are not very small. So at the moment we have about 700 terabytes of traffic being delivered every month on average. And we have been events and special occasions where our workload have been up to 10 million requests on our web services in an hour. And the bottom line is we need to be very careful about scalability. So we are not consumer-oriented, we don't have Facebook-like problems, but we serve content to a consumer audience. So we have something very close to Facebook-like scalability problems. And this is why we use a lot of services from Amazon Web Services. It's not, I don't care if it is not, if you're not able to read this slide. The point is that the red rectangular are the services we are using today, and this list is increasing on average each 2 or 3 months, and we have been very active in exploring new services that we have available. So what I want to do this evening is to share a few specific cases which in my opinion are very important to understand why it is important to think in a cloud perspective when you are designing architecture or software. Because the world is changing, the pace this change is happening is very high, and the technical debt is becoming very, very hard to solve as a problem. So you have to stay up on par with the evolution. If you get behind, it's very hard to get back. So our overall technology is really nothing too special, nothing too innovative. It's a normal layered approach with front ends, application servers, and the back ends. The point here is that when you are facing several different services you offer, like artificial intelligence, you have content distribution, you have access control logic, the number of elements of your architecture that have to work together becomes high, and the problem quickly switches from managing the infrastructure from an IT perspective to managing the infrastructure in a way that the problems are solved by themselves. So the infrastructure is able to solve the problems by itself. And this is one of the key points. Let me give a very basic example. We have been on the market for a long time, so for a few years, a long time, starting in year 2000. This project is more recent, from 2014. So we have been working with the known cloud architecture. And what happens when you have a fault is that you have to fix that. What you can do today, what you can do with the cloud perspective is that you don't have to spend time to fix the problem. You fix the service. So you can just create a copy of whatever was working, put everything back up, and then you spend time in looking for the how, what went wrong and how to fix that. So you are able to be very quick in recovering for a service failure just because you can create infrastructure, you can create services dynamically and with a very low cost. And what the two aspects I want to share with you this evening are two of the points that, in my opinion, have been very successful in our choice of using cloud and leveraging cloud architecture to solve our needs. The first one is, and I will be very quick on this, it's transcoding. When a user uploads a video, a document, a picture, whatever, digital asset, what the first thing we do is to process this content to create all the different quality, size, resolutions, versions that are needed to allow this asset to be played on the different devices, different bandwidths, and whatever. And this workload, you might think that it's already available. There are so many transcoding services in the market. Why did we implement our own one? And our challenge was that we needed to transcode several different type of assets. And at the time we implemented this, there was no single market solution that was doing that. So just an example, there were video transcoding solutions and there were document transcoding solutions, but there were not a single solution managing both. And from a cost perspective, this was really a pain. So it was cheaper for us to implement that ourselves and learn how to do that in a good way. And this was so successful that we have been learning how to transcode video in a way that we still have problem. We have a challenge in finding commercial solutions providing the same bitrate to quality ratio that we are achieving with our own solution. And the point of why doing that with cloud is that we cannot predict the workload. We are not able to expect when a user starts uploading, I don't know, 1,000 videos or 1,000 documents during the day, during the night, on different time zones. So this was a very good example of an infrastructure that just sizes and creates itself based on the need and destroys itself based on the need. And this gives performance, gives availability, and gives a very good cost ratio, because you're just spending from what you actually use. And this is the average cloud use. I think you already heard this a lot of time. So why am I bothering you with this? Because you can extend this concept further away. And the other example is analytics data. We monitor how users interact with content, so we have our own analytics engine. And the reason we do that is that we really needed a control over the data flow, over the process, and because we needed a content analytics solution instead of a web page analytics solution. So we didn't find anything on the market helping us. And I told you before, we apply artificial intelligence, we analyze images, documents, so we do semantic analysis, image recognition, and things like that to understand what an asset is about. So if you upload, I don't know, a picture, we analyze the picture to understand which are the elements of the picture, how the picture is composed, which is the style, and those type of things. And we automatically tag this asset to enrich its value. Because when we understand how users are using these assets, which assets they are interested to, we can study which were the characteristics of those contents that users were checking. So we are able to understand which are the characteristics that users are interested to. So we needed a very different data pipeline if compared to what a typical analytics solution provides. And the reason why we choose to how we leverage cloud capabilities to achieve this might not be so straightforward. So what is an analytics pipeline? It's really basic. User viewed content. We have something typically client-side that triggers a message to the server that that collects the event, enriches the event with the several processes, like enriching the event about which are the tags that describe the semantics of the content. You have to understand who is watching this content, track the user, track the device, track the identity, and so on. And then you are able to put this data to a database or somewhere where you can query this this information. So looks straightforward, it was so straightforward that we started studying how we could do that with the big data approach, so Hadoop and whatever. And we realized that there was something called Lambda architecture, because one thing we needed to solve was the ability to have real-time updates of the analytics. So the challenge in having a real-time update of the analytics is that some things are very quick to compute, like new events. So you have counters, things like that. It's easy to add some of them. Some things are very complex to compute, like model changes. What is a model change? Let's say I have an asset, like a picture, the one before, and I have people watching that picture, and someone updates the picture, that very same picture, and changes the picture. So the semantics of the picture change. You still are receiving events about people watching the picture, but they are watching a different thing. And you have to update the data about the semantics of what they are checking. And this is tricky, it's not so easy. So the purpose of the Lambda architecture, I'm not going to be very detailed on this, but this comes from Wikipedia, the biggest source of starting points when you have to study something. And basically they say it's easy. You have a data flow coming from the left, and you split data into two different pipelines, a real-time one and a batch one. Why? So the real-time one is the one you are receiving queries for to have quick update on the data. The batch processing typically is what is processing the model changes. So the idea is that you run the batch process once a day, and you will have a real-time update which are not updated with the model until the next day. So the next day you will have still real-time updates, but you will see the model change. And one thing that is missing on this diagram is that one basic, one step which is very important is how do you switch from the batch process data to the real-time data. And in our architecture, we had a constraint which was very strong, which was that we needed to update model changes also backwards in the past. So for some cases, when, for example, a company says that a concept, which is the color of that chair, is lemon, and after a few days, they realize that the lemon is too specific. They just want to say that that's yellow, but they already have some yellow tags in their system. You have to merge this data. So you have to process all the historical data to update all the old views that were based on the lemon to say that they are on yellow. This means that this approach can't be done on our infrastructure, on our need. And what we had to do was a slightly different version of this, which is actually a Lambda architecture with a green-blue deployment approach. It means that you have a production pipeline, data is being received, there is some AWS names here, Kinesis is just a very fast queue. So data is being received, it's being enriched from a snapshot of the model from the day before, and then you write this, enrich the data into a very quick database to process the queries, like Elasticsearch, which is an excellent tool, by the way, and you have all your services querying this this data. And this works like a charm for real-time updates. Then you create a new pipeline, which is similar, but it is not using the very same snapshot of the model. So it's the exact same pipeline using a different model, and you start receiving new data in real time on both pipelines. Queries are still here on the old one. And this goes for a time, because you have new model, you start receiving new data, and after a certain amount of time, you will reach a situation where you have all the data you need with the new model, and then you switch the front end in querying the different pipeline, and you can destroy the old one. And this sounds easy, or somewhat easy. Reality is that it was not really so easy. The point is that this diagram, or the Wikipedia one, is conceptual, it's nice, you can understand it, you can do all the analysis, and then when you want to implement that, the actual architecture is not so straightforward. Don't worry if you cannot read it. This is actually the high-level architecture diagram of a single pipeline I showed you. So on the blue-green deployment, this is just the blue branch. And you have the real-time part, the batch part, and the fancy colors are just to tell you why we are proud of using the cloud approach for this. Because the orange boxes are serverless computing. So they are all places where data is being processed, there are triggers that are being launched, there is code being executed, but there is no server to manage. It's all event-driven, it's all about the flow of the data. And the blue one is a solution we use as a starting point to do the analytics part. It's called Snowplow. If you are interested in developing your own analytics tool, check Snowplow. Everything is written in Scala as a language because we like functional approach. And the green boxes are just the AWS services. So it's a very detailed view, but the point is that there is not a single server into this diagram. There is no physical infrastructure being managed by any one of our IT department, which leads to very interesting different approaches to debugging, because it's not so easy to log information, but it's very powerful, and it allows you to design the architecture and the data flow in a visual way. So one of the tools you have in Amazon is AWS Data Pipeline, which is an interesting tool because it allows you to design the infrastructure I showed you before just by explaining how data is flowing between the different components. And the components usually are serverless functions that are being executed. So if you are not familiar with serverless functions, Lambda functions in the AWS terminology, the biggest goal I have tonight is go home and check them, because that's a very important part of the future if you are going to code in the next years. And this is also a lead to a very important message I want to give you, and it is that the way we are coding, the way code is going to be made, is different, is changing, and the roles inside the company are changing. So just to share a few lessons we learned with this experience. The first one, DevOps, which was a very popular buzzword a few years ago, is actually very important. It means that whoever is managing the infrastructure with these approaches must be, or it's better that it is, the coder. Someone that is also writing the code. Because managing the infrastructure is actually about writing code today. And this means that it is also very nice to leverage things like containers and things like that, because the most you are able to lift from the physical infrastructure and abstract the interactions, the better, the easier it is to manage the infrastructure. So one point here is that as a role in a company, the mix between a developer and an IT guy is a big deal. And it's not easy to find this skill, it's not easy to scale this kit into a company. The price to pay is that it's very hard to guess how it is going to cost, how much it is going to cost, because it's dynamic, but also because you don't have the normal parameters. How many lambda functions you pay for, how many seconds of execution you have. How many seconds are going to spend in elaborating that data? No idea. So it's not easy from a company perspective to do planning about costs, and it's very hard to automate tools that provide you good dashboard about how much you are spending. Because this is new, there are a lot of tools, but there are no real easy solutions to see how much you are spending. And for the people that are spending time on AWS, a few suggestions. In our experience, the average lifetime of an instance is 1 year. So don't plan for having a long time, long life instances, because they're going to die in 1 year max. And if you're going to go for reserved instances to reduce costs, be aware it's not an easy choice, because reserved instance is you pay upfront for a few years and your spending is fixed. Sounds nice. The problem is that this also means that you are paying upfront for something that you don't know if you're going to use and how you're going to use in the next years. And if you are a company, you want to plan for 3 years. But as you are aware, 3 years in this type of technology are a very, very long time. Things are going to change a lot. So are you ready to commit for 2 years or 3 years spending on a size of an instance? Might be, not so easy. And yes, go for support. AWS support or any other provider, cloud provider support is very important, because things looks very shiny, nice, but when you start digging deep, you start doing non-trivial things with that, things break all the time. And sometimes, since you don't have access to the infrastructure, to the logs, to the servers, you cannot do anything. You have to rely on support. And the most important thing is that once you start doing this, you start doing serverless applications, you start doing a pipeline like I showed you. The point is that you start using things and concepts that are very specific of a single vendor. Azure is very different from Google, which is very different from AWS, and so on. So from a risk management perspective, do you really want to put all your apples in the same basket? Or do you want to have a plan B? Well, having a plan B in this approach can be very expensive, it can be not so easy, because not all providers are providing you the same thing. So the example I made you about the pipeline, in my opinion, is a very good example, because if we want to port it into a different cloud provider, we might not be able to do the same. And also, and this is, in my opinion, one of the most important messages I want to give you tonight, is development role is changing. And we see that happening, and we see too few events where people are speaking about that. If you just check, even just AWS, or check whatever cloud provider you want, the level of abstraction, what is a commodity, is becoming higher and higher and higher. So the role of the developer is becoming different, because you don't need to spend your time and resources into coding things that are commodity. So you're switching from writing code to design process, design flow, manage events, which is a very different thing. And I think there is not really a lot of education on that. University or even companies are not teaching that enough. But this is something that is happening, and it's very important. So in my opinion, you have to become better in designing architectures, designing flows, understanding algorithms and design patterns, because the building blocks you can use today are so powerful that the time you spend is more about connecting those building blocks than creating new building blocks. Inside the company, this is not easy to achieve. You might have the vision, but sometimes it's hard to get the trust of your boss or your company in having this change of mindset, in experimenting new things. So the bottom line here is, yes, learn how to code, but keep an eye on this type of evolutions, because they are going to disrupt the way you are working in a company for the next years. Few references. I think the presentation will be available later. Just a few words. Snowball, I told you before, if you're interested into Lambda architecture, understanding how to process big amounts of data information, this book is, in my opinion, very good. And Elasticsearch is a solution that is known to create search engines, like typical queries. Give it a try, give it a check also for very fast analytics or database query, because it's unbelievably quick. And if you want to provide users real-time updates, this solution is excellent. And if you have questions,
a big applause. Well, I would say, perfect presentation. He says, don't ask any question, but we have time for questions. So at least two or three from the audience.
How do you test?
It's a very good question. So how do we test? We have different environments, like development, quality, and production, because we create them and we destroy them. We mostly do that. And testing is actually very hard. So we are actually spending a considerable amount of time in creating tools that automatically test things. The type of test you can do this way, what we do actually is end user perspective testing. So you query your services with high load, low load, all the parameters, and from different geographic solutions, and you check the result. One thing we have been starting using lately is to have a layer behind the front end, based on a container, that splits requests, send them to the two different versions of the code. One is the production, which replies to the user. The other one is just the new version, and we do not reply to that. We check the difference. If there is a difference, accurate interpretation. Does this give us an answer? But it's.
I imagine it's more.
No,
much
but
more
the idea is this, and it's, testing is hard. And if you start not having servers, debugging testing is very hard, because you have to change your mindset in how you do that.
I assume you can do unit testing quite easily with Lambda.
Repeat it.
I suppose you can do unit testing pretty easily,
because yes.
You're basically testing functions.
Yes.
But then testing the whole thing.
Exactly. This is, if you have a complex infrastructure, a lot of different components, and mainly based by different teams or different developers, the integration testing or testing the whole thing, yes, it's hard. What we can do today is test from the end user perspective and check the results. Might not be enough, might not be the best way, but this is how we do that.
Thanks.
Two more questions. Thank you for the talk, it was really interesting. I have a question about the architecture. Did you start right away with a function as a service architecture, or with a more traditional approach?
We started with we started with a non-cloud deployment at the beginning, and then we had a rewrite from scratch. We designed everything for the cloud, but there were no Lambda functions, things like that. So we are switching, we are changing, refactoring our architecture step by step with the different modules, even for containers. We don't have everything on containers right now. And for serverless features, right now, today, you cannot do everything serverless. basic example is when you need persistency, but the other thing is that serverless functions have strong limits like time of execution, so some type of workload you cannot do that. So it's still something evolving, so it's a step-by-step evolution. We don't have everything in a functional approach. Now, if you are thinking about the language, functional aspect of the language, we choose Scala to be able to switch from object-oriented to functional. We are mostly doing that functional.
Okay, I was interested in the serverless part. And did you migrate from the traditional approach to serverless or functional service because of scalability problems or for other?
Costs are a very interesting factor. So whenever you can save costs, it's not just infrastructure costs, it's management costs. How time you need to spend to manage the infrastructure. We are software developers, we hate spending our time in managing servers, networks, and whatever. So even if you have a software as a service or a platform provider that gives you all the building blocks, spending time in configuring, I don't know, VPC, LANs, firewalls, whatever, or managing the size of the instance, it's just a waste of time. So if you can avoid that, do that.
I would say one final question, somebody from the VIP area. Well then, we'll find, yeah?
Yeah.
Hi. Someone? Peter.
So you said it's, with cloud it's very easy to like create new pipelines or like, new environments and do them down. But do you have, like, which kind of automation do you use for that? Like, I suspect you don't like click buttons.
No. So, by the way, one thing, it's very easy to create an infrastructure. It's not so easy to destroy infrastructure because you have to be sure that it's not doing something important when you destroy that. So we still have parts of manual intervention. So you have scripts, deployments, and even AWS provides you tools to deploy part of infrastructure with a manual trigger. And we still do that, but we also have automatic scaling of things. For example, on the transcoding, we coded the logic that describes if we have to provision new machines to transcode. So it's a mix. Let me say that for the high risk from a scale perspective workloads, we do completely automatic scaling. For things that can be managed with I don't know, a few hours or even one day delay, we do that manually at the moment, but we plan to automate that. The reason we do that by manually is that we prefer to be very, to have a perfect way to automate that manually because we are able to intercept errors and then automate. Because when you automate starting from something you know very well. If you start right off to automate everything, the risk of creating cascade failures in production is high.
Another big applause.
Thanks again to our speaker. As always, we have 5 minutes break, people. You can go to the toilet over there, you can go out, take a breath. Or you can go there and take a beer, or you can go there and make a donation. So thanks again to Dario, and 5 minutes break.
Thank you. quindi loro di base dicono, invece di adottare le basi, facciamo un contenuto e vediamo come funziona. La parte intelligenza artificiale invece di quelli so, riconoscono le cose che sono nel posto, le taggano da sole.
Beh sì, è un servizio che viene da questo.
Ciao, ciao. Va bene?
Devo aspettare.
Ah sì. Bellissimo.
Sì.
Ciao Gianni.
No, ho detto questa cosa in camera.
Sì, tra l'altro tutto quello che abbiamo detto sulle dirette di Facebook, per cui non potrà mai più essere pubblicata.
Una persona sola che ascoltava. Non scappa.
Please take your seat. Find the gap between the frame and the platform. We are now arriving at the garden.
Zona Albert.
We are now arriving at Zona Alberi. Howdy, howdy! So, thanks for staying for the second guest. Probably most of you have already run home because it's very late and tomorrow we are at school. But, alright, so, for the second guest, a big applause to Alessio Guerrieri from Spazio Dati. And we will talk about Spazio Dati. Thank you very much.
Working with data and doing some science on the data.
So what is Spaziodati? Spaziodati is a former startup. It's not a startup anymore because it has gotten too old for this. So you originally focused on data integration and extraction of information from text, and now it works mostly in the corporate area. So we have a lot of data about companies in Italy, about the corporate world, that we get from the Chamber of Congress through another company. And what we do is we integrate with this data with additional sources. Sources that come from open data, so that it's available to everyone, or sources that we get ourselves, which is the topic of this presentation. All this information, we then sell it through a portal that is called Atoka, that is given to the companies that want to find information about other companies. Just to be clear, we're not talking about secrets. We're talking about public information about companies. And we also serve it through APIs, and we do some data analytics, data machine learning tasks to find companies that are similar to others to help companies finding clients, basically. So this is the project that I will talk about today, the Internet Data Gathering Project. Now, this is a project that started around 3 years ago, and that is my estimation looking at the logs of the Git that we still have, because I wasn't discussing that at that time. And the concept was to try to extract information that is valuable about companies from the web. So from the complete World Wide Web, try to get as much information as possible about companies, Italian companies. So then we can resell this information and allow people to search this information. The entirety of this pipeline is also built on AWS, so we connect pretty well with the previous talk, I think, because we use not as many services as Tron does, because Tron has really large coverage, but we do use some of them. So we will have some overlap, and I will skip stuff that was already said. So I will start from the conclusion. So this will be the conclusion of this presentation, so that you can have them in mind and understand what is the point of the rest of this presentation. First of all, is that web data is horrible. You want to analyze, you want to extract information from the web, from web data. Web data is not challenging, it's horrible. It's also challenging because it's horrible. It's basically a complete mess of noise from which you have to fight really hard to extract information. So it can be fun. It's also very painful. The second point that I want to make is that open source software can help a lot. So you don't have to start from scratch. There is a lot of open source software to do analytics to extract information and to allow you to clean up all the noise that is in the world and to extract something that is valuable. And the last point is that for big data, you need big frameworks. And by big, I will explain what big means, because it means very different things. Not only the fact that it can work with big data, but also other data. Oh, one point that I want to make, I will also talk about Elasticsearch because it is very important. So I'm really happy that it was mentioned in the previous talk. So the first step, crawling the corporate web, which is getting the information from the web to a place, to a storage service. We do everything in the cloud, so we still use a cloud storage service, but the idea is the same. We want to download the internet, basically, which is kind of a difficult task, as you can imagine. To download the internet, we use a web crawler. What is the web crawler? It's a service that crawls the web, basically. It will start from a set of domains, a set of websites. It will download them, parse the HTML, find outlinks toward new domains, new websites, and then add them to a queue. And it continuously, so it will download also those new websites, find new websites, and then find new websites, and then find new websites, until, well, forever, basically. It will never finish downloading stuff, because the internet is ever expanding and endless. But this is the idea of the process. Luckily, you don't have to build a crawler yourself. We didn't have to build a crawler ourselves, otherwise it would have been a bit painful, since Spaziodati was pretty small at the time. But we are still kind of small, but still not big enough to justify building our own crawler. There is, luckily, a service, a software. It's called Apache Natch. It's part of the Apache Foundation. So it's open source, available for everyone, and continuously developed. So there are new versions of this crawler available pretty regularly. It's distributed, so it can run as a Hadoop job, Hadoop is, for the people who doesn't know, it's just a framework so that you can run some code on 1,000 machines and not worry about anything going wrong. I make it very, very vague, but hopefully that will be enough. It's also very highly configurable. So you can change a little bit of pieces, you can add plugins to an app, your own customized plugins, so that it does exactly what you want. And the flow is what is shown by this very clear picture. You can all see very clearly all the words that are inside this picture. So the idea is that basically there is an injector who is an external service that maybe finds new URLs outside of the crawler from some external sources. It will find these domains. It will add it to a database of URL, which is which is called CrawlDB. And then there will be a service that's called the generator that will take the URLs that are in the database and decide which are the ones that it wants to download today. Which are the ones that are important? Maybe the one that we didn't download for a lot of time. So maybe the last time you downloaded this of the homepage of Tron was 5 months ago, and we said, the Discord partners will say, we should download this homepage, otherwise we lose information. This valuable information. These URLs then are given, are divided into segments, downloaded in parallel, parsed, so the HTML is parsed so that we can extract out links to our other domains, and those domains are put back into the CrawlDB. And this is a sample, basically. Here in Spazio Dati, we did some work on these two components so that we have it customized for our need. I'll remind you that our need was to download the Italian corporate web, just the information for the Italian companies. Because downloading the entire web was a bit too much for us. We still could do it maybe in the future. I think our CEO may want to do it at some point. But at least for now, we focus on Italy. So we have an injector, a bunch of injectors actually, who looks in Twitter pages and Facebook pages to look for domains that are likely to be company web pages, so that we are sure that we want to download them very often. And also the scoring function here, we select those pages that are more likely to contain information of value. So, for example, team pages or job pages are places where you can find very important information about what a company does, and so we would like to prioritize downloading those over downloading some page that is deep inside the website and not very interesting. In Spazio Dati, we run it as an Hadoop Elasticsearch EMR job. Weekly filtering on IT domains and domains that have been registered in Italy. We have information from WHOIS, which is a database of domains, for which you can understand where a domain has been registered for, so that we can select only those that are in Italy. Well, it's a superset. We select all of them, all websites that have been registered in Italy. Sometimes we do also others because we are not that precise, but mostly we do. And we use a cluster here of 50 machines with download roughly 12 billion pages per week. This is the number of URLs that we have in our DB of URLs, so the number of pages that we have downloaded, and we have just gone over 1 billion pages this weekend. And according to a presentation of Professor Montresor this afternoon, this was what Google had into around the year 2000. So we are around 17 years late from Google, but we are still here. Okay, we are just focusing on detail. And so we have some. We don't have a lot of data, but still this is 5 terabytes of HTML files that then we need to analyze. Which you can understand is a challenge. And we'll talk about it later. So crawling is not very easy. Before Aaron asked a question about testing. How do you test a crawler? How do you test that you improved a crawler? Considering that the internet is changing every day, and if you run up the same crawler twice the same day, it will get two completely different results, because there are also all the caches in the internet, all the DNS, everything changes. Basically, it's very, very difficult to test and debug a crawler. You need to be very careful with all the changes that you do. You have to be very careful to see the final product. And sometimes you have to wait until the final product to understand that something was wrong in the crawler. And so you still have to wait to do a lot of work to make sure that everything works. And still, there are a lot of issues that come from outside of yourselves. maybe some person sees that there is a guy from Spaziodati who is trying to download their homepage and they don't want that. And so they ban you. This is okay. We don't mind about it. We don't change the user rate. We don't try to cheat too much. We try to be polite. But still, we can do distributed denial of service attacks by chance. Because we are using a distributed system to download these pages. And so sometimes it could happen that all different machines are trying to download pages from the same websites at the same time. And those websites will see like 20 concurrent gets from different machines and will say, let's ban this user agent. And so you have to do some work there. We are currently dividing the URLs so that each machine is, all the data about our website is downloaded by a single machine, so it's done sequentially. And so we are sure that we are not downloading the single website from different machines at the same time. So that we are not, so this way we avoid this issue. We don't avoid it completely because from the domain you cannot understand which is the actual machine that is serving that domain. So maybe a machine is serving more domains, and so we still have this issue. It happened also once last year, I think, with the actual public administration website. But it happens, so it doesn't happen very often. And also we have an issue of crawling very too deeply, so we shouldn't crawl too deep. We don't care about downloading the entire website of every page, of every website in Italy. We care about the important pages. We care about the home page, we care about the job page, the team page, a few important pages. We don't want to go so deep inside. You cannot see here, but this is a query on Amazon, basically. It's a very, very long page. You don't care about downloading all of that because then you will never end, basically. You never get all the information that you want. Still now, we have this part done. We have this part done. So we have a dump of the Italian internet. It's not a complete dump, obviously, but if we have a dump of the Italian internet as in the form of HTML files. We want to process that. So a JSON with HTML and metadata is not very useful by itself because the HTML, you can do a few things with it, but you need to process it before you do anything with it. And we want to extract some structure information that is domain-based. We don't care about searching for a specific page. We mostly care about searching for a website. We care about website, not about pages, as part of that. And we want to do this in distributed processing. And we do a bunch of extraction here. We do a lot, we parse HTML, we start extracting a lot of features from. Some of them are quite easy. We extract, for example, the text. We extract the outlinks so that we can find which pages, websites are linked to which website, which is very important information because you can understand which companies are collaborating with other companies in this information. You can find that maybe I think Belka's web page, for example, is linking toward some web page, I think. And so you can find this link and understand, well, there is a connection between. And this is invaluable information if you can analyze them all together as a graph. I will not talk about much about graph, but I wanted to say graph at least one time. So, you have also some information that is okay to extract, but there are still some issues here. We can extract, for example, social accounts of a company from the web page. You can think, well, maybe just if a company has a link toward a Twitter page in its website, it's probably its Twitter page, not. Don't miss, obviously, because sometimes people are adding Twitter links toward Twitter of stuff that they like. And so you need to understand which is which. And you have a lot of cases, you have to look at a lot of data, a lot of horrible data, because web data is horrible. And you need to look at them very precisely. And then you have complex information that you need to extract. This is a difficult task, really heavy algorithm stuff, some of them. The first one is not really heavy, it's a bunch of regex actually. We want to extract which technologies are used by a website. So which CMS, if they're using JavaScript, if they're using something else. You can understand it by looking at the meta information in the HTML. There are services that do that, and we have our own version of an open source service that does that. And I'm not actually sure how it works because I know nothing about a website. Then you have entities, you can do entity extraction, so extract important entities from a page, and this can be done with many named entity extraction algorithms. Or maybe you can extract people. You can find mentions of people on a website. You can find what is the theme of a company. And this is extremely valuable information that you want to put on the page, on our service, you want to put the information about this company that it has this kind of people. Because in the Chamber of Commerce, there is no information about the fact that I'm working for Spaziedati, for example. The only way to know that it is public is to go to the website. On the website of Spaziedati, and you find me in the same page. Clearly, if the page is not updated, you will not find the people that work with it. But this is a case that do not happen very often. Mm-hmm. This stuff is done with Hadoop. So Hadoop, as I said, is a way to distribute data, distribute processing algorithms. So basically, you define a function that given an input will compute an output. In this case, a function that given the HTML will parse it and output a JSON with all the information that we extracted through 1,000 different stuff. We have a lot of features that we extract from the HTML that have been all crafted by hand by our developers. And then we give it to Hadoop, and Hadoop will do all the rest, basically. It will store the input data, divide the machine, give each piece to a different machine, run our code on each different page, on each different domain, and then save the results in some ways. And we do this because, clearly, we do not want to do the architecture ourselves. That I was saying, this is stuff, this is effort that could be spent doing more interesting things and more valuable things. And so we trust Hadoop for this. And for the Hadoop, and the system that we use to interface with Hadoop is Qt. Now, this is maybe not as famous as Hadoop. I don't think it's famous. I hope it's not famous as Hadoop. Basically, it's a scripting language for Hadoop. You can define a pipeline through a script. You can use standard Hadoop functions so that you can do count, word countings very easily. Or you can define your own user-defined function that do the analytics. For example, the one that I told you before from HTML to JSON. And then you write this simple script. You give it to, actually directly to Amazon, because it has a service that can run Qt. And Amazon will bring up the machines, give the data to each machine, run through this script, using everything in parallel. Each of these steps will be run in parallel on all the machines in the cluster, and then it will give you the result. So I will not go through this amazing code, but basically what it does is load some data, then count words, and then output the number of occurrences of each word. It's the standard word count example that is usually used as example for distributed frameworks for data processing, the one. You may have seen it before if you studied Hadoop or Spark or other distributed frameworks. So, in our pipeline, what we do is basically we compute for each page the domain, then we group together the pages of the same domain, so that we have it all in the same page, and we can do analysis on a domain base. And then we extract information from each domain, so that from using a big script. We also integrate data from other sources, such as cookies, and then export a JSON for each domain. And this runs monthly on a cluster of around 30 machines for around, I think, 10, 12 hours, something like that. I'm not really sure. I don't remember anymore. It's also very difficult to test. This is a framework that has not been used as much in the last few years. The development of Qt has not gone much forward, so it has been a bit abandoned. And this makes it also a bit updated. In general, if something breaks in the Qt script, to debug it, so define what is wrong with the Qt, as you can see from this picture, it's pretty difficult. And this comes back to what I was saying before. For big data, you need big frameworks. Not only frameworks that are used by a lot of people, that can analyze a lot of data, but also that can be used by a lot of people. Because if you start using a big data framework that then becomes abandoned, you are screwed. You need to do a lot of work then to get back into a working pipeline, because if something breaks, the situation is very bad. With Qt, it's not that bad. It has received a new version this year, actually, I found out, that supports Spark, so it is really, maybe it's still alive, but still, it's not a very, very nice framework. I will talk, there are nicer things out there to use for this task. Then, you have the last step. So, you have a bunch of JSONs. One JSON for each domain. What do you do with it? By itself, it's basically useless. Because we are talking about hundreds of gigabytes of data, and if you want to find information about even a single one, it's a mess. What can you do? You can put it into a database. You can put it into Postgres or MySQL. They have support for JSONs now. You have the JSON, like a JSON type field in those databases, but they are not built for that, basically. They cannot be used to do complex query on structured data. And so we need to find a way to do it this better. And as Dario said before, there is a solution, luckily from that, which is one, I think the software that we use the most is Parsedati, because it's in a lot of different places, and it's Elasticsearch. It's open source also this, according to, I'm continuing the theme of open source software that we use at any point when it's possible. And it's based by a Mnemosyne index, which is highly efficient on disk index. It allows you to do queries on a huge amount of data in very short time with very few resources. It's extremely fast, extremely flexible. It has so many features that we still have to use all of them, I think. Some of them we are using without understanding them, probably. But there are a lot of interesting stuff in Elasticsearch. It also allows you to have a cluster of Elasticsearch machines that share the load, which is also very nice, because we can use it also as a backend of our service. So, what do you do here? What do you do when you have everything in Elasticsearch? You can query on it. And the query is defined as a JSON. So this query is, I'm sorry if you cannot see this guy. I hope it will be a bit bigger, but I probably chose the small, a smaller font that was necessary. So this is basically, you tell it as a query, give me all the domains that are in the text spec. And this tells me the size, which is 5, and this tells me, do not give me the actual content of the page, I just want to know which are the websites, basically. I don't care about the content, because otherwise we will show it here. And here you can see some results. The first is titospec.it, the second is derpsire.it, then the spec.it, bayonamusic.com, and simulifeature.it. So you see here, the fourth result is bayonamusic.com. What does it mean? Well, the algorithm behind Elasticsearch is quite good, but it's not perfect. You need to be, and this is web data. Web data is very difficult. You cannot just query the piece and get good results. Bayonamusic is a festival that was done in a place where this festival was called Speca. And so it was mentioned in a lot of places in the website, basically. And so doing a query on Speca, we find that it's extremely relevant, this website here, which is not a very good result. You need to build queries that are more complex if you want to analyze your data. You need to be careful of everything. You cannot just search for a word in the text. If you search for spec and tab, you get some more nice results. Here you're giving more to the Elasticsearch cluster to work with, and you can find that we are finding the home page of spec and tab. We are also finding the web page of one of the organizer. The third one is francescobonadiman.com. The second one is specitechis.com, that I didn't know it existed. It's a shop, but I found it's not about spec. It's about specis. This fake is about tech. You can find the website and if you want, and I will try to understand why this was an important query. But clearly, this is not a database that we give directly to the user. We cannot. This is web data. We cannot give data directly to the user and expect that they will understand why it is like this. You need to do a lot of processing. And there are a lot of steps after indexing, on cleaning the data, on making sure that the data is as clean as possible, on making sure that when we extract emails from a mail to tag in HTML, it's actually an email and not something else. Because there is something else often there. Because people cannot write HTML properly. And we have to analyze that HTML. You can do a lot of other complex queries. For example, I told you that we extract the technologies from the web page. And so we can actually ask which websites are still using the 3.0 version of WordPress, which is an old version, as far as I understand from my very, very, very old knowledge about CMS. And you can find it here, you can ask it, and it will tell you that there are around 200 websites that we have in the index with a very old version of WordPress. If some of these websites are of companies that work in tech, we have some information about that company. Or maybe you can ask what are the most used CMS in Italy? Which are the CMS that are used the most in Italy? And you find that the first is WordPress, then there is Joomla, Drupal, DM, Podopoly, Sid, Weebly. I have no idea what these things is. But basically, you look at this and you say, yeah, this is interesting, but so what? This is extremely important information. We had, for example, a client that was selling to its customer a CMS, but also selling other products. And they gave us the list of their clients. And we found that their clients do not use their CMS. Even if they're buying other products from this company, they do not buy their CMS, because their CMS is pretty bad. I will not say the name of the company. But you can ask me. And so you understand that since we work with companies, we work on finding new clients for a company, all this information, if you bring them all together in a place that is a structure and that you can analyze them quickly and do some data science activities, then this is extremely valuable. And this adds something that the other companies in Italy who do lead generation cannot do, because they do not have their internet in their pockets, basically. And I'm using the word internet in a very vague sense. So I will finish with a few comments here. First of all, this is not the complete pipeline of internet data gathering. I did not tell you about how we find which website corresponds to which company. I did not tell you how we find it. This is a very complex stuff. How we join the information from the website with information from the Chamber of Congress, and how those enforce each other. So that if we find any information on the web and also in the Chamber of Congress, that is must be important. And we do all this stuff. This is an actual real picture of how the pipeline of this small project looks like. And it's a bunch of different processes that has been built through time. And Spaziodati, since it was a startup, it was using different technologies at different point of time. So we have a different, in there we also have Spark and Scala, for example. And we also do some extraction information from social networks about the amount of Twitter followers or Facebook friends of a company, and we can find a lot of interesting stuff from that. And this is all in this internet data gathering project. But it's too big to do a presentation here. So we'll conclude with a few things. So first of all, the first takeaway is that all of this stuff has been done using open source software, and then changing it a bit. To make it do exactly the work that we wanted. So that it does what we want, but it's still based on open source, so we can still use all the work that has been done in improving this open source software. You need to work with a little few things, but you need to also to be extremely careful. We all know that on the internet you find information that is false. This is common knowledge. But also on the internet you can find HTML that is false. You can find a HTML that is completely wrong, that is completely unstructured, and you still want to extract something from it. You can find emails that are not actually emails, and you can find a lot of things. And so, to work with web data, you need to always an open mind, and always expect the worst from the data to extract what is the most valuable for the company. So, I will cross this presentation with a quick comment. Since if you like this kind of stuff, if you like working with very difficult data, with horrible data, which is challenging but it's also very interesting, we have open position, you can look at them on the website. And this is the end of this marketing part.
It sounds stupid, but there are a lot of people that say there's no work in Italy, and they have it. And there are a lot of companies that are looking for talents, so just try to look on the Spaziodati website and you can find them. Questions? We know it's late, there is a spec waiting, but there's still 5 minutes for the questions. Whoa. Luckily, we have a microphone that allows us to
go to our first spec attackers.
Such technology.
Hi, how do you parse the HTML?
Very good question. So, here again we have two options. We can write our own HTML parsing code, or we try to use something that is open source and is continuously developed. So we use the second option. In the parser here, the indexer uses JSON. I think I'm correct at this. There are my clients that say yes. My colleagues that say yes. So yes, we use this JSON library to parse the HTML, and then we process each part separately, manually basically. Once we have the structured HTML, we do the analytics there.
Two more questions.
How do you decide what part of an HTML page is good or not?
Okay, this is more complex. First of all, what we first try to do is to understand extract the footer of a page, first of all. So, the part at the bottom of the page. Because for company web pages, that is the part that contains the most information. It's often the part that contains the partita IVA, which we can use it to understand which is that company. And it also has information about contacts, about addresses, and so that is the most important part. So we start trying to detect there. If we find information there, good. Otherwise, we start looking in the text, we start looking in there. And we start extracting things from it. And here the idea is that, for example, this is a very complex scenario in which we have a lot of cases. But for example, if you want to extract emails from a website, you look at the page, you see how many emails there are using Navigex, for example. And you try to validate them using some email validation libraries. There are open source email validation libraries also, so you can use that. But the idea is that if you don't find any emails, then the page doesn't have much information. If you find 1,000 emails, that page is probably cracked. So that if you find very few information, or if you find too much information, the page is probably something that you don't care about. Because if there is that much information on the page, it's fishy. It doesn't look like a real page that's been done by a person to advertise the company. And so it is safer to throw away that information than to try to parse it and give it to the clients.
Another question.
Do you evaluate?
Wait a second. So we also have people connected to Facebook.
Do you also evaluate the quality of an HTML page, or you don't?
The quality of what?
Of an HTML page, of the script, the quality of the code of.
So, no, we don't do evaluation of the HTML. Okay? Well, if the HTML is wrong, probably we won't be able to parse it. In that case, we are safe. The issue are stuff that are more weird, such for example, links with the href field that is to something that is not a page and it is an event, for example. The stuff that they are correct from the HTML definition, but they are not actually correct. So that is what we do.
Final question. We are drafting the winners of the JetBrains licenses, so you have time for the final question before you know who's going to win a 1-year license. I don't know. Yeah, you want one?
More like a curiosity than a question. I believe that understanding what there is in a web page can be a very challenging task. Do you think there is, I don't know if you're using machine learning or some kind of neural network to understand that, but do you think this is a direction that is going to be better result going, in the future? Because I see a lot of progress in that area, and I have no idea if it is being applied to this.
Okay, so we are thinking of trying to, we don't currently do deep analytics. We do some machine learning in trying to when we try to match a company to a web page. There we use machine learning techniques. But in general, we are not currently using deep neural networks because they usually need a lot of training data. And we have basically zero training data. The only way we get this is to crowdsourcing techniques, such as websites, to people, have them manually analyze the page and then use that as a training set, basically. That is what we do now for a few tasks. But to do it on a larger scale, to extract information, to, for example, classify web pages, which is something that is extremely interesting and we would like to do in the future if we can, we need to find a way to build a training set that maybe is not perfect, but it's good enough that the algorithm then can converge to something that is fine.
Even just for understanding what a footer is or an header is still the same problem. I have no idea, I'm just asking.
Do we don't?
We tried the footer, we tried the footer in the past.
This is our CTO. Please applause to our CTO.
We tried it with the footer both in the past, but at the moment for that we're just using rules. That would have improved, but we never had time to implement that in tuning. Yeah, because it takes a lot of time to compute the footer, so it was not worth it at the time. And then we just forgot about it.
Thank you.
I would say it's done. Yeah? Another applause for our speaker. So you see me looking at my phone, but it's not because I'm chatting or whatever. I'm actually looking at the winners of the... I'm on Telegram. I'm looking at the winners of this raffle of licenses for JetBrains. So we have three names. First one... Oh! Caterina Aloe. Come on stage, raise up. Ciao. She doesn't know what she won, but anyway, she made a donation, so she's worth it. And I think her boyfriend will use it, yeah? Hello. Second one. Another girl, Elisa Bassani. Oh. And final one. Oh. Matteo Simone. So these three people will win, if they want it, a license for 1 year of JetBrains, and they will come with me after the event to our desk to get the license. Okay, so we have three final points before closing the event. First one, there's always the table there if you want to go leave a donation, if you want to buy an awesome t-shirt, it's how we live on, because we have to pay a lawyer, we have to pay an accountant, we have to pay a number of things to keep the association running. So you can really help us if you donate for the association. Second one, speaking tech is not always like that. Tonight was very, very, very technical. Both talks was very deep. We have awesome speakers. Not all the time is like that with having such a huge quality of the speakers and having such a deep detail of the data. And sometimes we also try to merge the tech aspect with the innovation aspect or with the business side and everything that is about these concepts and entrepreneurship. So we tried to do a 50-50. This time was very, very the tech and we are very happy, but it's not always like that. So if there are some of you that really didn't understand much about the talks, it's not always like that and just come for the next time. And final point, you're sitting on some chairs and we need to put them on a side. So if you're very good at maths, you will see that some of the chairs are similar to each other. You just stack them one on top of the other and you put them here where I actually move in this beautiful stuff.
So yeah, you will move them here, and then there is going to be our ballette that will bring out the speck and the beers for all the rest of the night. Thanks so much for joining us, and we see you in 1 month.